Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Luke, chapter 1. Luke, chapter 1. It's Advent, beginning of Advent. Christmas hit the stores and the malls about 6 months ago, and anybody get beat up on Black Friday? Anything happen? I don't see any black eyes, and then we had what? We got Cyber Monday and Small Business Tuesday, and then Bankruptcy Wednesday, and got all kinds of holidays to look forward to. Sandy and I live on a block here in Hutchinson. We moved to, we didn't know this, but then our realtor told us about the block. The deal is if you don't really decorate for Christmas, and I mean gaudy, they'll kick you out of the neighborhood. We could actually get kicked out. But we're really struggling this year because the guy on our block who had his whole house, he was like Clark Griswold. I mean, his whole house and the lights flash with the music. That guy moved. And we're without a leader in our community. Somebody's got to come in and help us. We don't know what to do. We're a community without a leader. So we're trying to struggle along with Christmas lights. But it's a crazy time of year. But with all the craziness that comes with this time of year, I am about to say something that might cause the ceiling of this church to cave in. I don't know. We'll see what happens. I am beginning to come to a realization that when it comes to Christmas, the retailers have it right. No, I haven't lost my mind. I've come to think that there's one thing that we can learn from Walmart and Target and TJ Maxx, and that is these guys have it right when it comes to the whole attitude of expectation and preparation and getting excited about a day. It's something. I saw this picture, and I wish I had it, but I saw this picture of a little town, and it was Christmas time in the little town, and the whole town was filled with lights. I mean, every store, everything, Christmas lights everywhere, Christmas lights on the trees, Christmas lights in the park. There were people walking around. Everybody was being nice and talking to everybody. Every place except the church. The church sat at the end of the square, and it was black. No lights, all the lights off, all the doors locked, no people anywhere. I thought, there's something wrong with that picture. What's going on that everybody is celebrating? We got ripped off. That's our holiday. That's what we're about, and they stole it from us. And in fact, before the big box stores stole it from the church, it's exactly what Advent season is about. Preparing our hearts with expectation for the coming of the Lord. Wow. We gave that away. We gave that to Target. What's wrong with you guys? In fact, Advent, the word Advent is it's an interesting word. It's a Latin word. And it has two tenses. It means arrival, and it also means coming. It has a present tense in that someone is here, someone has arrived. But it also has a future tense. Advent can mean someone is coming, someone is on their way. Pretty brilliant word to use, and the early church used it to talk about the fact that someone is coming soon and someone has already arrived. The early church started the Advent season to focus on two things. To focus on the fulfillment of all the Old Testament prophecies, like Nathan read about this morning, the fulfillment of the prophecies in the Old Testament leading up to the coming of the Messiah. That's one of the reasons for Advent. But the other reason that the early church started Advent was because as the bride of Christ, as the church, we are the ones who are awaiting the return of the Messiah. He's been here, and he's coming back. And here was the thinking back then. When Advent was started back in the 4th and 5th centuries, the thinking was, you know, God's Messiah has come into the world the first time, and a lot of people weren't ready. A lot of people weren't listening to the prophecies, they weren't believing the prophets, and it was one of the reasons why Jesus was crucified, because people just weren't ready to hear the message of Advent. And they said, but the other thing is this, he came the first time and we weren't ready to receive him. Jesus could return for us today. Are we ready? Wouldn't it be cool? Jesus, maybe he comes back while the kids are playing the bell choir thing. And all of a sudden, all the bells just fall on the floor. Wouldn't that be awesome? Yeah. Well, they'll probably do that anyway. But I mean, because they're gone. So I think it's there was something going on in the hearts of the early church that created this spirit of Advent. They started it to say that the Old Testament's prophecies are fulfilled. Jesus Christ has been born, but God's Messiah is coming back. And we have to be ready. In fact, when they did this, something I didn't know, but as I was kind of prepping for this message, I didn't know that they did this, but the early church, during Advent season, that was the time when they baptized new believers. They would baptize new believers and celebrate the body of Christ during that time. And we just happened to be doing that on December 14th here at Riverside. Now, we're doing it during Advent season. We're doing it because I can't get in the water yet, so we moved it. Usually we do it in the end of November. But in actuality, when the body of Christ created Advent, part of that celebration was baptizing new believers and celebrating the fact that we are the bride of Christ and we are prepared for the return of Jesus Christ. Isn't that cool? That's kind of a God thing. I thought that was neat. And the Advent season always begins 4 Sundays before Christmas Day. And this year, that just happens to be today, November 30th. And that's why Deb started the Advent candle, and we're gonna do that as a part of our celebration around here. But I'm praying, you know, this coming week, people are going to be here to decorate the church. And so if you want to come and help, I want the outside to just look as marvelous as the inside. Because that's a statement that hey, this expectation thing, that belongs to us. That doesn't belong to Walmart. Amen? The anticipation of the coming of Christmas, that belongs to the church, not the world. And so I'm excited about that. Expectation, hope, preparing yourself, preparing your spiritual walk, preparing your heart, anticipation. That's the spirit of the Advent season, and it's something that gets kind of garbled up in the world that we live in. But these are the things that surround the coming of Jesus and his birth in the beginning. And they also are there surrounding the return of Christ as well. And they should be there every single day of our lives, not just this season of year, but every single day of our lives. We need to walk in the spirit of Advent. Jesus is coming soon. Are you ready? Amen? In fact, turn to the person next to you and just ask them that question once. Jesus is coming soon. Are you ready? Are you ready? So, I have to tell you, the retailers have it right. But we need to take it back. And I want to kind of do that this morning. In the book of Luke, the story around what happened before Jesus was born is a story of incredible anticipation and preparation. And there's a lot going on before Jesus ever shows up on the scene that is amazing in this regard. Now, the first thing is this. 15 months before Jesus was born, people were getting ready for Christmas. You talk about, I mean, you know, we have Christmas in July. That's nothing. 15 months before Jesus is born, heaven is moving and preparing for the advent of the Son of God. You can talk about Best Buy being early. They've got nothing on the early church. And I want to take a look at a priest. His name is Zacharias. He's John the Baptist's father and the spirit of Advent. In chapter 1 of the book of Luke, verse 5, it says, "In the days of Herod, king of Judah, there was a priest named Zacharias of the division of Abijah. And he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous in the sight of God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and requirements of the Lord. But they had no child, because Elizabeth was barren. And they were both advanced in years. Now it happened that while he was performing his priestly service before God, in the appointed order of his division, according to the custom of the priestly office, he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. The whole multitude of the people were in prayer outside at the hour of the incense offering, and the angel of the Lord appeared to him," to Zacharias, "standing to the right of the altar of incense. Zacharias was troubled when he saw the angel, and fear gripped him. But the angel said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your petition has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will give him the name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and he will drink no wine or liquor, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit while in his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the sons of Israel back to the heart of their God. It is he who will go as a forerunner before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers back to the children and the disobedient to the attitude of the righteous so as to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Wow. Just think about that message for a minute. And now Zacharias answers. Zacharias said to the angel, verse 18, "How will I know this for certain? For I am an old man and my wife," he is advanced in years. He doesn't say she's an old lady. That wouldn't be good to do. He's advanced in years. And the angel answered and said to him, "I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God. And I've been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news." Now, that's not a tender thing. Gabriel's a little bit ticked off. "Who do you think you're talking to, buddy?" And behold, verse 20, "You shall be silent and unable to speak until the day when these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their proper time." Wow. This entire chapter, even you could read the whole chapter, and it just resonates with two things: anticipation and preparation. Anticipation and preparation. A spirit of expectation that made the early church say, "You know what? We need to do something around here to make sure that our people never forget this." And Luke wrote this 40, 50 years after it happened. He wrote this, and then when he finished with the book of Luke, he went on and wrote the book of Acts and the story of the early church. And somewhere in that period, the early church started saying, "You know what, we've got to go back and we've got to do something that makes sure that we don't forget the anticipation and the expectation of the Lord." And that's where Advent came from. And when you look at this story, and you see the spirit of Advent. You see it in Zacharias himself. Here's the deal that isn't said here, but there were 20,000 priests serving in the temple in the time Zacharias was a priest. 20,000. They were in divisions, and they were on a schedule. It was a very organized thing, and verse 8 and 9 says that when Zacharias' division was on duty, He was chosen by lot to go behind the veil into the Holy of Holies and offer incense on the altar of incense. 20,000 to 1, those are the odds, that man on that day would be behind the veil offering incense to the Lord. Wow. This is a moment that Zacharias had hoped for and prayed for his whole life. He became a priest. Nobody knows. Only, you know, priests serve their whole lifetimes and never do what Zacharias got to do. Just being faithful and serving out their time in the temple and doing what they're supposed to do. But their names were drawn by lot, and it was kind of a game that takes too long to explain, but it was kind of like a roll of the dice. And, oh, my number one, okay, you get to go behind the veil. And you get to sprinkle incense on the altar. And most of the priests, though, went their whole life, 20,000 people. Yeah, you know, most of them go their whole life and never experience what Zacharias got to do. His name got called. And he's a man probably in his 60s, advanced in years at that time was in your 60s. Now you're still a kid, like in your 60s, like, you know, I'm not even there yet. I'm still in my teens. I've got a ways to go. But here's a man in his 60s, and he's standing in the holy place. The golden menorah is in front of him. The golden candlestick is on his right. The table of showbread is on his left. And just in front of him is a veil. And behind that veil is the Holy of Holies. And the first thing that you walk into when you go behind the veil is this altar of incense. And the priest who is chosen by lot to go beyond the veil and do that carries with him all the prayers, all the hopes, all the waiting, all the desires, all the anticipations of Israel. And they take it in the form of incense and sprinkle it on that altar. And the smoke goes up. And it is a pleasing savor unto the Lord. And the symbolism is absolutely incredible and powerful and beautiful. But it's all about anticipation and hope. And just this act alone in this story is a picture of hundreds of years of hope deferred, of people waiting and hoping that one day prophecy would be fulfilled and Messiah would appear and Israel would be free. They were under Roman oppression now. They wanted to be free. Anticipation, the spirit of Advent. Zechariah had gone through his whole life rehearsing this moment. What happens if my name gets called? I've got to know what I'm going to pray. I've got to know how I'm going to distribute the incense. I practice this. I think about this. I pray for this my whole life because I might never get to do it, but what happens if I do get to do it? It was just the chance to stand behind the veil and to be the one. That's incredible to think about. And then all of a sudden, here he is the one. He's there in the tangible, physical presence of the living God in the holy temple. And then also in this story is the anticipation around the angel Gabriel himself. There's a flash of light, and there, right before Zechariah, verse 11 says, right to the right of the altar of incense stands the angel of the Lord. And not just any angel of the Lord. I mean, we're not talking about Clarence standing there hoping to get his wings, you know. This is Gabriel. There's two archangels in all of creation, Gabriel and Michael, and this is one of them. And he's standing before this man. And he too has been waiting for centuries to deliver the message he's about to deliver. Think about Gabriel for a minute. Gabriel says to a 60-year-old man, you and your wife are going to have a son. And you're going to name him John. Your son, Zechariah, is going to be the one who rekindles the hope of Israel. And your son is going to be the one who lays the highway, who makes the way for the advent and for the work of God's Redeemer, his long-awaited Messiah. Your son will be anointed with the power and the anointing of the prophet Elijah, and you are going to be the one. Your son is going to be the one to usher in the Messiah of the Lord. This is incredible news. And you need to prepare the way because he's coming. I just want you to put yourself in Gabriel's shoes for just a minute. I mean, Gabriel has been waiting to do this for thousands of years. Ever since the creation of human beings, the plan of salvation was in God's heart before we were ever created. God knew what would happen. And the archangels were in it. He says, I am Gabriel, verse 19, who stands in the presence of the Lord. I'm not some guy up on a cloud somewhere. I know what God is doing, and I can just see Gabriel throughout all the years of history. Can I go now? Can I tell him now? Is it time yet, Lord? Can I go now? God's right. Can I go? Can I tell them? Can I make the announcement that the Lord is coming? Oh, you know, you think about his job. I mean, he's had other assignments. Gabriel spoke to people of God before. He spoke to Joshua. He spoke to Jacob. He spoke to Daniel. But to speak to Zechariah, to announce your son will be the one to announce the Messiah, to tell Mary, Gabriel, same angel, goes to tell Mary, you will be the mother of the Christ child. This is the season that Gabriel's been waiting for his whole life. Can I go now? Can I go now? Is it time yet, Lord? Can I go? The expectation, the spirit of Advent. That's incredible. And even the unborn baby, John the Baptist is 6 months older than Jesus. And so when Mary goes and tells Elizabeth that she's with child, John the Baptist has been cooking for 6 months. How many moms remember when your baby was 6 months? Did any of them do any dancing? Any jumping? Yeah? Yeah, I remember when Zandy had our two there. Every once in a while, we'd go like that and get a kick. This kid does more than just a kick. John the Baptist reveals the spirit of Advent. Verse 39 through 41 in the story, Elizabeth, Zechariah's wife, is 6 months pregnant with John, the last Old Testament prophet, the one that the angel said, you need to name him John, and he would be the one who would announce the Messiah. And John the Baptist's whole life was about expectation. His whole life, on the day before he dies, he was beheaded. He'd been announcing Christ. He'd been baptizing people. He'd been pointing them to Jesus and saying, he's the Messiah. They finally imprisoned him for that. And they, before they beheaded him, he sent a message out to Jesus to say, man, are you the one? Because you're not acting the way I thought Messiah would act. I thought you'd come down and kick the Romans and set up the kingdom, and you're not doing that. You're doing other stuff. And I don't know, am I giving my life for no reason? Are you the one that we've been expecting for thousands of years, or is there another? And Jesus says, take it easy, John. I'm the one. I'm the one. It's okay. It's okay. John's whole life was about Advent, about the coming of a Messiah. Jesus says, you're a true prophet of God. I'm the one Israel seeks. That even before John was born, before Jesus was born, the spirit of Advent was at work. Mary learned from Gabriel that she is the one that God chose to be the mother of Messiah. Think about that. You, Mary, are the very first human being to carry Jesus Christ inside of you, to have God living in you. You're the first one. And Mary, you are the first human being to give Jesus Christ to a world that's lost and dying. You're the very first one. That's what you get to do, Mary. And it blows her away, and she comes over to Elizabeth's house and she tells Elizabeth the exciting news. And the baby, John the Baptist, he hasn't baptized anybody yet, But he's in there. He's 6 months along. And the Bible says that John leaps inside his mother's womb. And when that baby does that, mom is baptized with the Holy Spirit. Incredible. Just the power associated with expectation of the coming of the Lord. And the beauty of that picture. The Spirit of God explodes inside of this woman. Her life has changed. You'd think with all of this anticipation and all this just wonder of anticipating the coming of Christ that the whole story would just be magic. But it's not. I mean, you would think that after talking with Gabriel the archangel, that Zechariah would have busted out of that veil. He wouldn't have quit running till he got home. Said, honey, guess what happened? Guess what God said? Guess what we're going to do? You're going to have a baby. You know, it would have been weird for her, especially. But the story doesn't say that that happened. In fact, what the Bible says is that Zechariah was kind of skeptical about the whole thing. And he says in verse 18, how can I know that you're just not some salesman? After all, I'm too old and my wife's too old and we've been without children our whole married life and we can't have kids and the doctors say this and they say that. And the thing that you're telling me sounds really good, but I don't know if I have it in me to trust you. Think about that. I don't know if I have it in me to trust you. Verse 23 says, he stays in the temple and fulfills his duty. He doesn't bust out of the veil and run home. He stays there throughout his assigned period of time. I don't know how long that was, 10 days, a month. I don't know how long it was, but he stayed there until it was finished. And then he goes home. And the Bible doesn't even say when he tells Elizabeth about the angel. I just get this picture. How are things down at the temple, honey? You know, same old, same old. Nothing. I mean, you have to be pretty jaded. You have to be pretty tired of hoping. You have to be pretty burned out to get to a point where 20,000 to 1 odds against you happen. And you win. You get to go in to where only a handful of priests in their whole life get to go and offer the incense offering. While you're there, the archangel Gabriel shows up and talks to you and about your wife. And about a child, not about, the wonders of God or the wonders of Israel or the future hope of the promised land. Nothing like that. You're going to have a baby, and I want you to name the baby John. Forerunner of the Messiah. This incredible supernatural experience happens to you all in one afternoon, and you come out on the other side saying, well, I don't know, seems a little far-fetched for me. How burned out do you have to get to let that go by? How jaded do you have to get to let something like that happen and just doesn't faze you? But see, he's not alone. As you read through the Gospels and the book of Acts, you see this happening many, many times in God's people's lives. Just the world conditions us to be skeptical, doesn't it? It conditions us. You know, if things are too good to be true, what? They probably are too good to be true. It's probably a sales pitch or something, you know? And you can think of Luke 24 and the disciples. Jesus tells them that he's going to die on the cross. He dies on the cross. He says, on the third day, I'm going to rise from the dead. He rises from the dead. He shows up where they're gathered. And what happens? The Bible says in Luke 24, 41, They saw him after his resurrection, and they did not believe it was him. It's a joke. That can't be him. Or Acts chapter 12. Peter's in prison, and the church gathers together, and they're praying for his release. They're praying, God, come down and help us somehow set Peter free. And an angel of the Lord visits Peter in the jail, knocks the chains off of his arms, opens the doors of the jail. Peter walks out of the jail, and he walks back while the church is still praying for his release, and he knocks on the door, and a young lady named Rhoda opens the door, and she goes, "Wah!" Shuts the door back in his face and runs in and says, "Peter's out there, but he's supposed to be in jail. I don't know what's going on." The thought that God would actually answer my prayers, I can't think that way. And it's something that happens to us. We get told, we get conditioned. You know, things can be dark for so long. Odds can be so high, stacked up so high against us that we lose any sense of anticipation. We don't prepare for anything anymore because we don't want to be let down again. And we pray with little or no expectation of God doing anything, because the spirit of Advent has been ripped off. But I want you to see how God ministers to Zechariah. And I love what he does, because he loves this priest who lost the spirit of Advent. God loves him. And here's how he does it. Verse 18, Zechariah said to the angel, "How will I know this for certain? For I'm an old man and my wife's in advanced years." And the angel answers him, "I'm Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God. And I've been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. And behold, you shall be silent and unable to speak until the day when these things take place, because you didn't believe my words." After being skeptical, in response to this news, Gabriel just says, "You don't get to talk. You don't get to talk for 9 months." Verse 60, and it wasn't forever. Verse 64 says that when John was born, you know, they want to know, what are we supposed to name him? And he writes on a little tablet or whatever, he says, "His name is John." And when that happens, his tongue is loosed, and the first thing out of his mouth isn't, "Whoa, what was that about?" It wasn't like he was, it says he exploded in praise and worship and thanksgiving to God. That's what he did when he could talk again. But I want to ask the question, why did God take away his voice? Why did God shut his mouth for 9 months? And what does it mean for you and me? And I think it's this. Sometimes the best news is often the hardest for us to believe. Life in this world of letdowns teaches us to be skeptical, teaches us to take people and to take everything with a grain of salt, and that slips into our faith. It slips into how we relate to God. Keep your expectations low and you'll never be disappointed. If it's too good to be true, it probably is. Don't go there. And while those axioms are very true in this world, because this world will let you down. There's no question about it. People will let you down. The world's going to let you down. But these things have no truth at all when it comes to the kingdom of God, when it comes to the word of the Lord. "I am Gabriel, and I stand in the presence of the Lord, and I came to share good news with you." But you've let the world, Zechariah, make you so hard and so cynical that you can't even hear what I'm telling you. And so, you know what, pal? I'm just going to shut you up for a while until these things come to pass. See, Zechariah got the kingdoms of this world and the kingdom of God mixed up. And so God closed Zechariah's mouth so that his ears and his eyes would be opened once again. And he watched his wife as that baby grew inside of her, knowing that he couldn't father a child, she couldn't bear a child, however it worked physically, it couldn't happen, and yet it was happening, and he couldn't talk about it. He could just sit there and wonder. He could just sit there and let his mind be blown as that little baby was kicking. And then Mary comes over one afternoon, and now Mary's with child, and Mary and Joseph, they're not even married yet. They haven't had relations yet. And the little baby inside of his wife leaps, and all of a sudden his wife starts speaking in tongues and is just blown away by the presence of God. And he can't talk about his conversation with Gabriel. All he can do is reflect on it. For 9 months, all he can do is think about what happened. 20,000 to one, and I'm there. And Gabriel spoke to me and gave me this news. And God gave him 9 months of silence, I believe, for one reason, and that was to renew in this beloved priest the spirit of Advent, the spirit of hope, the spirit of anticipation, the spirit of expectation, the spirit of preparation for my God. He is coming. And I got to get ready. I've got to be ready. The God who does great, impossible things is on his way. And contrary to the lies and the letdowns of this stupid world that we live in, Jesus says, if Jesus says, I'm coming soon, there's only one response. And it's not when, and it's not who says, and it's not what calendar, and it's not what this, it's not what that. It's, I better get ready. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Because I'm coming. Hallelujah. That's the spirit of Advent. The spirit of Advent. That's what we're here to do this coming month. I want to see such a sense of expectation that it just blows Walmart and Target right off the street. I want to see you guys walk in and they do all their marketing stuff to get you excited to buy something. You say, I don't need to buy something. I'm so excited Jesus is coming. He could come today. I'm excited that he came, and because he came, I know he's coming again. That's the way the early church saw it. Would you bow your heads with me for just a moment? I just want to ask a question. What would happen in your life, in your body, in your home or your family, if you allowed the spirit of Advent to be stirred up in your heart again? What would happen if what took over is an incredible sense of anticipation and hope? An expectation and faith and belief in a miraculous God who does impossible things. What could God do if you prepared the way of the Lord for his coming? What could God do? Heavenly Father, we come to you as a people who, just because of the world we live in, get so jaded. It just gets hard sometimes to hope and see nothing happen, to pray and see nothing happen, to go through the motions, and our expectation begins to wane. We begin to buy the conventional wisdom of the world rather than the truth of the Word of God and the kingdom of a living Lord. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would restore in every person in this room the spirit of Advent. That we would walk out of this place today prepared and ready for what you would do in us and through us. Oh, Holy God, don't let us walk through this season with either ignoring it because of the world, what the world has done to it, or buying into what the world has done to it and missing its meaning, or just going through the motions that are religious, going to the programs and going to the stuff. But Holy God, come and touch our hearts, Lord Jesus, with a sense of the wonder of the fact that your Son came to this earth and changed everything. And if there's even one person who does not know you, who has not received you as Savior, today's the day. Today's the day to be saved, to have the first Advent become real in your life. If you've not received Christ as your Savior and you'd like to this morning, would you just slip up your hand? I want to pray for you. You've never asked Jesus into your heart. And you say, Jesus, I'm celebrating Christmas, but I don't even have a relationship with you that's real. Is there anybody? I want to just pray for you. Praise God. And Holy Spirit, take a hold of our hearts. Take a hold of our minds. We are a people that have a theology and have a belief from the Word of God that you are returning and that there is nothing that needs to be fulfilled for you to come back. You could come back before this prayer is finished, Lord. Help us to expect and anticipate and be ready for the second advent of Christ. In our personal walk and in our relationships with you. And let this Christmas time celebrate that relationship with your glory and with your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have a need and you'd like prayer, we have some prayer teams that'll be up here to minister to you. But I want you to get out there, and when those people at Walmart or Target, they're just especially friendly, would you just go right back at them? Boy, I can't wait for Christmas to come too. And then tell them why. Tell them why. The spirit of Advent. God bless you.